A happy feast of unleavened bread to all of us. The title of this message is Behind the Mirror. First, what is a mirror? According to Wikipedia, a mirror is an object that reflects an image. Light that bounces off a mirror will show an image of whatever is in front of it when focused through the lens of the eye or a camera. Mirrors reverse the direction of the image in an equal yet opposite angle from which the light shines upon it. This allows the viewer to see themselves or objects behind them, or even objects that are at an angle from them but out of the view, field of view, such as around the corner. Natural mirrors have existed since prehistoric times, such as the surface of water, but people have been manufacturing mirrors out of a variety of materials for thousands of years, like stone, metals, and glass. In modern mirrors, metals like silver or aluminum are often used due to their high reflectivity, applied as a thin coating on glass because of its naturally smooth and very hard surface. That is according to Wikipedia. Now, mirrors are essential in our everyday lives, don't you agree? We look at it as part of our morning or evening rituals, an aid to our personal grooming. It is also most important to women. Who among you women does not have a mirror in their purse or bag? For our discussion this morning, we will venture deeper on the usage of a mirror rather than its skin-deep application. Today is the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. We can use this feast as a mirror in order to see what's behind it. And what is behind it? What is behind the mirror? Well, it is our image, our reflection. We see our true selves behind the mirror. God expects a certain character trait to be seen in Christians, and that is us, the way He sees us, not the way we see ourselves. Does this trait reflect His righteous character or our very own human and carnal attributes? In our reflection, do we see our righteousness, or I should say, God's righteousness, or our human nature? Do we see leaven in us in one way or the other, or are we unleavened? Do we see ourselves as God sees us, or do we see ourselves the way other people see us? Our frail human nature can be deceiving, if not all the time. It is the only thing that is preventing us from achieving our goal, which is building righteous character, a character that God wants us to have. It is the thing that we should overcome not only during this feast, but throughout the days of our lives. When facing the mirror and seeing something we don't like can be sensitive at times, especially when it comes to our Christian walk. That's where leavening comes in. We even sometimes cover it up because we are ashamed of it or even deny it. No wonder what is happening in our lives is nothing new. The Apostle Paul rebuked the Corinthian church with almost similar circumstance. We can read this in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 6. I'll be reading from the New King James Version all throughout. He said, "Your glorying is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump?" That is why we should be true to ourselves and our calling. We should not deceive ourselves. When we see something wrong in the mirror, we should take responsibility to take action against it and correct it. Let us not waste time to correct ourselves or make excuses before it's too late. Let us take heed what James said in James chapter 1 verses 22 to 25. James chapter 1 verses 22 to 25. He said, "But be doers of the word and not only hearers, only deceiving yourselves. If anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it, and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does." The look behind the mirror can be deceiving. That is why when we see something in our reflection that is amiss, when we see leavened, we should take a step back and reflect on God's word and correct ourselves. We should be always be honest. 2 Corinthians chapter 13 verse 5. "Examine yourselves as to whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. Do you not know yourselves that Jesus Christ is in you? Unless indeed you are disqualified." There is only one way to be unleavened, that is to be like Jesus Christ. That is the very purpose of the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread that we are celebrating today. During the Passover ceremony, we observed last Friday, it is a reminder and the renewal of our commitment and covenant with Jesus Christ and our God the Father. 1 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 8, Paul said, "Therefore, purge out the old leaven, that you may be a new lump. Since you truly are unleavened, for indeed Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the leaven, unleavened bread, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth." Also in Romans chapter 13 verses 11 to 14. "And do this, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than we first believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness," that is leavening, "and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy," again leavening, "but put on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lusts." Having Jesus Christ live in us, we can then echo with confidence what Paul said in Philippians chapter 4 verse 13. You said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. With that, our lives throughout should be a reflection that of Jesus Christ. Galatians chapter 2 verse 20. Paul said again, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. So, the reflection that he sees is not himself, but of Jesus Christ. That should be the same with us. And the life which now I live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Romans chapter 8, verse 28-30. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, that is us, this he also called. Whom he called, this he also justified. And whom he justified, this he also glorified. In closing, God's feasts are our season mirrors to see our reflection as God sees us. But let us not stop there. As often as we look at the mirror in our everyday lives for our grooming and whatnot, may we look into God's Word as a mirror to see our daily image if it reflects with God's character. Having Jesus Christ live in us is the best reflection we can have behind the mirror. The object we see behind the mirror is our true reflection. Not a reflection on what we want to see, but a reflection on what God wants to see. It is up to us to correct, with God's help, the reflection, especially in times of trials, according to the image God wants us to have, to be holy and perfect. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 15 to 16. But as he who called you is holy, that is God, you also be holy in all your conduct. Because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. And finally, in Matthew chapter 5, verse 48. Therefore, you shall be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Happy Feast of Unleavened Bread once again, brethren, and God bless us all. Thank you.
Wash me and I'll be whiter than snow. Happy Sabbath and happy Feast of Days of Unleavened Bread to all. In the latest report from Johns Hopkins University, COVID cases worldwide already reached more than 120 million cases, and death toll recorded almost 3 million people. If you look at the figures, it only represents a very tiny portion of world's population of 7 billion. And yet, the pandemic brought the world's economy down and even near collapse to other countries. The vaccines from different countries have started to roll out since late last year. However, the first world producing countries obviously prioritizing their citizens. Vaccines like the AstraZeneca of UK, Pfizer, Moderna, Johnson's and Johnson's of US, Sinovac of China, Sputnik V of Russia, and Covovax of India. The world supplies of vaccines is limited, and the third world countries like us seems on the least priority of the list. So far, only four of the mentioned vaccines, AstraZeneca, Pfizer, Sinovac, and Sputnik V, have obtained EUA or Emergency Use Authority here in the Philippines. With the present world scenario now, the cases are surging again because of the surface of the different variants of the virus from UK, South Africa, Brazil, and according to the news, it seems that there's also a new variant here in our country. It seems that the second wave of the pandemic has started, and most of the countries are implementing again strict measures or lockdown. In the history of the pandemics, normally, it lasted for a minimum of 2 years. We have now entered on the second year of the COVID pandemic, and many people from different segments of society were already being affected mentally, morally, financially, and even the spiritual life of everyone. Today is the first day of this year's Days of Unleavened Bread. And this is the second year that we have to observe it virtually, except for some local churches where social gathering is already allowed. This feast, the Days of the Unleavened Bread, the Passover season, reminds us of our Christian life. And for a year now, this pandemic impacted deeply our spiritual life as we experience this in our lifetime. As Christians, we are reminded every year during this feast that we need to have a constant communication with our God through His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Paul, Apostle Paul, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 in verses 16 to 18, encouraged the Christians as he wrote, and I quote, he said, "Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus." He said, rejoice always, pray continually, and give thanks in all circumstances, and this is God's will for us in His Son, Jesus. Today, being the first day of the feast, I will deal with what verse 17 says. It says, pray continually, or in other translations, pray without ceasing. Brethren, the title of my message today is Pray. In these times of uncertainties, we have to heavily rely on building our communication channel to God. And that's part of building our closer relationship with God, which is prayer, or to pray. What is prayer? How to pray? What should we pray for? And I'm pretty sure most of you have a long list of things on what we should pray. But today, I will do my best to just simplify it and make it more meaningful when we pray to God. The word prayer, according to the dictionary, is a devout petition to God or an object of worship. It is also a spiritual communion with God or an object of worship, as in supplication, thanksgiving, adoration, or confession. And it's also the act or practice of praying to God or an object of worship. So prayer is an object of worship. It is a tool, it is a channel where we express our petition to God. Prayer is a powerful communication tool for the Christians to talk with God, to utter petitions, requests, supplications, and of course, thanksgiving. Jesus, in His famous Sermon on the Mount, taught us how to pray. And we will read these verses in Matthew chapter 6 in verses 5 to 15. Let's read the account. Let's start in verse 5. "And when you pray," He said, "do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly I tell you," He said, "they have received their reward full. But when you pray," He said, "go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them," He said, "for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. This then is how you should pray, according to Jesus. And then He said, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. Here, Jesus gave an outline on how to pray, of which other religious groups have used this for their repetitive prayers. Jesus gave an outline, but not the prayer itself. Today, I will give four important letter words on what we should pray to God as outlined by Jesus. The first letter word is P for praise. Praise for who He is, praise for what He has done. In the outline it says, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. A prayer of praise of God's sovereignty, of God's magnificent name and power. In the past messages, we have learned the different names of God, different characters and attributes of God. And some of them are Elohim. What does Elohim mean? The Creator. There is also this we call El Shaddai, which was used by a popular religious group in our country. El Shaddai means the all-sufficient one. Then there is what we call Jehovah Jireh, the Lord will provide. And then there is Jehovah Rapha, Rapha, the Lord who heals. Then there is Jehovah Shammah, the Lord is there. So you have the Creator God, you have the All-Sufficient One, you have that this Lord that provides, and you have the Lord who heals, and the Lord that is there. The mentioned names of God are just only few of the many names used in addressing God as expression of His characters and sovereign power and will. However, Jesus taught us to pray and call our God, and He plainly told us to address Him as the Father. He said, Our Father. He said, My Father is your Father. Yes, He said that to me and you, that God is our Father. To call God as our Father is the most endearing and the most personal address to God, as He really is our Father, and Jesus, His Son, is our brother. The word Father simply means to be the Creator, the Founder, the Author of life, the One who originates. And these are exactly what all the names of God meant that we have read. And that is being a Father. And that's why Jesus Christ taught us that we should call God our Father. In our prayer, it is very important that we address and praise God appropriately. God is our Creator. He is our life giver. He is our provider. He is our sustainer. And He is our Savior. It should be in this context. that whenever we pray to God. God is above all over His creations. He is the supreme being. He is the Almighty. He is holy and He is a spirit being. His different names carry the awesome powers and the abilities of God. And yet Jesus taught us to plainly call Him our Father. In our prayers, this is the most important one, that we should know who is the one true God, our Creator, our Father. Praising Him in our prayers should be the most important part of it. Okay, so that's the first letter word, P for praise. Okay, outline for prayer. Next is R for repent. Okay, repent of sins that we have committed, repent of commands that we have violated and neglected. In the outline, it says, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. The key here in repentance and asking for forgiveness is that we should forgive first our debtors. And this is what was Jesus said in verses 14 to 15. And He said, for if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forget others, their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. True repentance is the acknowledgement that we are sinners and we sin against God's laws and commandments. And as a sinner, we should also learn to forgive others who faulted and committed sins against us. To explain further, Jesus told us a parable about the unmerciful servant. And this story was written in Matthew chapter 18 in verses 21 to 35. Okay, let's read the account. Let's start in verse 21. Then Peter came to Jesus and Peter asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to 7 times, ang tanong niya. Hanggang ikapitong beses ko ba siya patatawarin? And Jesus answered, I tell you, Peter, not 7 times, but 77 times. So what does Jesus Christ mean? 70 times 7 times. That is 490 times. Can you ever count a person that can sin against you more than 490? Wala naman siguro, di ba? Okay. But what Jesus Christ is saying, forgive. 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 Up to 490. And then He said this parable, therefore the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And as he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. Ang laki ng utang, ano? 10,000 bags of gold. Wow! Can you ever imagine that? How many millions of pesos of that? And then he said, at this, the servant fell on his knees before him. And the servant said, be patient with me, he begged, and I will pay back everything. So the servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. Guys, ah, canceled. Brethren, canceled the debt and let him go. But when that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. Mas mababa. Okay? 100 silver coins lang compared to 10,000 bags of gold, di ba? Okay. Gold and then silver. 10,000 bags, ito, 100 silver coins lang. Mas mababa ang utang. He grabbed him and he began to choke him. Okay? And he said, "Pay back what you owe me," he demanded. And his fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him. He said, "Be patient with me and I will pay it back." But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into the prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. And he said, "You wicked servant," he said, "I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you?" In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. And then he said, "This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart." So, brethren, when we pray and repenting of our sins against God, make sure first that we have forgiven others who faulted us. All have sinned and come short to the glory of God. No one is righteous. So that's the second letter word. So we have P for praise, R for repent. So we'll go to the third one. A for ask. Okay. Ask for the needs of others. Ask for our own needs. In the outline, it says, "Give us today our daily bread. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." Yes, always remember to ask in our prayers. And what do we pray for? What do we ask for? And what are our requests? But before we ask, we should give thanks to God. First, for all of His provisions, guidance, and protection. Jesus, as part of the Sermon on the Mount, reiterated this ask. Ask. A-S-K. A for ask, S for seek, and K for knock. And this was written in Matthew chapter 7, verses 7 to 12. And He said, "Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks, receives. And the one who seeks, finds. And to the one who knocks, the door will be opened." The question is, or are, what do we ask from God? We ask for daily bread. We ask for daily protection, especially during this time of the pandemic. We ask for daily guidance. A lot of people right now are having some mental health problems because of the pandemic, of the situation out there, inside the house, outside, the protection, okay, and everything that the problems that are being encountered by most of the people. We should ask for daily guidance. We should ask for the welfare of others. We should ask and it will be given to us by God. And in this pandemic time, we need each other's prayers. We have to ask for the safety and the protection of everyone. And we should ask for the welfare of the people of this world. Yes, let's pray for the world so that the whole world can pass through this pandemic. And that we will be able to overcome during this difficult time. And what do we seek for? We seek for the truth. We seek for better understanding. We seek for wisdom. We seek for enlightenment. And these things that we seek will give us insights on how we deal with our day-to-day problems. The truth will set us free. The understanding and the wisdom will lead us to greater insights about God's plan for us and for everyone. And the enlightenment will lift us up during the downside of our life. And what do we knock for? We knock and kneel in prayer for our bold requests. We knock hard so God will grant our wishes. And what will be our wishes? Maybe a match partner. Maybe a nice shelter home. Maybe a safe car. Maybe a fruitful career. Maybe a prosperous business. God is willing to listen to our bold request. There is this story of a man who was knocking at his friend's house while in the middle of the night. The story is in Luke chapter 11 in verses 5 to 13. This story is in the same chapter in the book of Luke when Jesus gave the outline for prayer. And let's start in verse 5 of Luke chapter 11. Then Jesus said to them, suppose you have a friend and you go to him at midnight and say, friend, lend me three loaves of bread. Okay? A friend of mine on a journey has come to me, and I have no food to offer him. And suppose the one inside answered, do not bother me. The door is already locked, and my children and I are in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything. Pare, natutulog na kami. Okay? Huwag mo na kaming istorbohin. And Jesus Christ said, I tell you, even though he will not get up and give you the bread because of friendship, yet because of your shameless audacity, or in other translations, your boldness, okay, your shameless boldness, he said, he will surely get up and give you as much as you need. So I say to you, he said, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. And for everyone who asks, receives. The one who seeks, finds. And to the one who knocks, the door will be open. And then he said, which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will you give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will you give him a scorpion? If you then, though you are evil, meaning human, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him. To those who boldly ask, God will eventually give it to you. When you knock harder. And going back to Matthew chapter 7 in verse 12, it says, and it is noteworthy, so in everything, He said, do to others what you have them do to you. For this sums up the law and the prophets. So I'll ask. When we ask, when we seek, and when we knock, we should also give ears and lend our hands to those people who seek, who ask, and knock on us. Let's do to others what we want them to do to us. And that's the golden rule. And let's include each other in our prayers. So that's the third letter word. The fourth is Y. And the word is yield. Okay. Yield my will to God's will. Yield my agenda to God's agenda for me. In the outline, it says, Thy kingdom come, and Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We know that this is in reference to the coming kingdom of God, but it also reminds us to surrender our will to God. Not tomorrow, but now. Okay. A few months ago, we had a great Bible study. And it is entitled Half a Plan, wherein our pastor mentioned about committing our goals to God. And by committing our plans and our wills to God, and let God lead us all throughout of our life. Let's honestly ask ourselves, brethren, have we ever really surrender our will to God? With all the day-to-day problems, with all the sufferings, the obstacles, the challenges, have we ever really surrendered our will to God or submitted ourselves to God? The fourth one, it seems to be the most difficult. Because it's in human nature that it's not that easy to surrender our will. Because sometimes we're afraid to know what's the will of God for us. And we are not ready to accept it. And that's the most difficult. But it is very important. Apostle James had an insight on submitting ourselves to God. In James chapter 4 in verses 1 to 12, we can read. He said, what causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? Talking of your own will, your own desires, he said. You desire, but you do not have. So you kill. Okay, your own will. Okay. What you desire, hindi mo nakuha. Okay. It harbors hatred in your heart. Okay. So you kill, he said. Okay. You covet, but you cannot get what you want, he said. Okay. So you quarrel and you fight, he said. You do not have because you do not ask God. Why? Because it's not God's will that is leading your life. It is your own desire and will that you want. That you want to be in your life, that you want to be harboring in your heart, okay. Not the will of God. And he said, when you ask, you do not receive, because you ask with wrong motives, your own will, not according to the will of God. And that you may spend what you get on your pleasures, he said. And he said, you adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. James, you're talking on where will you submit or where will you commit your life? To God or to this world? Okay. On whose way and will you follow? This world or God? And he said, or do you think the scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the spirit that he has caused to dwell in us? Talking of God's gift of the Holy Spirit. But he gives us more grace, he said. And that is why scripture says, God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. And then he said, submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. If we surrender and submit ourselves totally to God's will, all the evil desires, all the evil wants and wishes accompanied by the devil will eventually flee from us. And then he said, come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, he said, mourn and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Talking of the worldly desires, said, it's two different worlds. Do not think about the worldly desires. Okay? It will really make you more sorrowful, more miserable. Okay? And he said, humble yourselves before the Lord, and the Lord will lift you up. And then he said, brothers and sisters, do not slander one another, because that is not the will of God. Anyone who speaks against a brother or sister or judges them speaks against the law and judges it. When you judge the law, you are not keeping it, but sitting in judgment on it. And he said, there is only one lawgiver and judge, and the one who is able to save and destroy. But you, he said, who are you to judge your neighbor? Talking of not the will of God. It is not our purpose to judge other people. And then he said, now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business and make money. And he said, why? You do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? He said. You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, he said, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes, and all such boasting is evil. If anyone then knows the good that they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin for them. Wow! What a great teaching from James, the brother of our Lord Jesus, talking of submitting ourselves to God's will, putting away our own will, our own desires, our own wants and wishes with the wrong motives. But he said, submit ourselves to God and put away all the evil desires and evil things and acts that we do. Okay? So there we have it, brethren. The tips on how to pray. Based on the outline given by Christ. In summary, when uttering or saying a prayer to God, remember the word pray. P for praise. We should know the one true God. We should know who is the Father and His Son, Jesus, whom our prayers are channeled to. Jesus said, let's call God as our Father. Okay. And praises to Him are only but necessary after all the things that He has done in our life. And that is the most important part of our prayer. We give praise to God. R for repent. We should always be humble before God. We are all sinners. We all came short of the glory of God. But before we repent and ask for forgiveness, let's forgive first our debtors, those people who have wronged or committed faults against us. The Father, remember, will not forgive us if we do not forgive others. And then A for ask. Remember, ask. Ask, seek, and knock. We should give thanks to God, and we should count our blessings before we ask for the things that we need, the things that we want, and for the things that we dream of. We should ask, seek, and knock. And it will be given to us. We will find it, and the door will be opened for us. It's not wrong to ask. Okay, your bold request, as long as it is according to God's will, and it's not amiss. Okay, so it's okay to ask the bold request. And then why for yield. And this is the test of our faith. Are we willing to surrender to Him? We should surrender our will to God and let Him lead our life. So let's follow Him wherever He leads us. And for sure, He will lead us to the gate of the kingdom of the Father, to the gate of the kingdom of God. The Father will lead us there through His Son, Jesus. Jesus gave us an outline on how to pray. And that is, remember the word pray. Praise to God. Repent of our sins. And ask for anything that we need. And to yield wholly our will to God. So when we pray, just remember the word pray. Praise, repent, ask, and yield. On that note, brethren, have a wonderful and prayerful feast to everyone.